Warning, the stunts and illusions performed on this program were designed and tested by Chris Angel, a highly trained professional. These demonstrations are extremely dangerous and should not be attempted by anyone, anywhere, at any time.
Tonight, you will see one of the most dangerous demonstrations of my career. Whether I live or die, you will witness it live, right now, from Clearwater Beach, Florida. Don't move.
Will be handcuffed to that sixth-floor balcony with just minutes to escape before the hotel implodes and is reduced to a pile of rubble. I'm your host, Tim Vincent, and we are live in Clearwater Beach, Florida, one of the most beautiful spots in America, for this very special first-time-ever live episode of Chris Angel Mind Freak. Chris Angel has clearly established himself as the world's greatest living mystifier and escape artist. With tonight's demonstration, he might very well surpass the legendary Houdini as the greatest of all time. And these are the loyals, the fans, 15,000 of them have journeyed here for this great event. Are you ready? Ladies and gentlemen, Chris Angel. Chris, I've got to start by asking, this is an incredibly dangerous thing you're about to try. It's live. We can see the fire service over there, the police, the security, paramedics. Is this one step too far?
We'll find out. I can tell you this, that my friend Guy Liberté, the owner of Cirque du Soleil, he's a dear friend, along with Felix Rappaport, the president of Luxor, both implored me, please don't do it. But I had to explain to them, look, A&E put me on the map, Mind Freak put me on the map, and I had to fulfill my commitment. So I'm here in Clearwater, Florida for 15,000 plus fans to do it.
The commitment and the fans are here, but what exactly are you going to do tonight?
I'm going to be restrained by a pair of handcuffs that I have not seen yet. They're going to be supplied by the lieutenant of the Clearwater Police Department. He was 26 years on the force, also the commander of the SWAT team. He's going to place his handcuffs on my wrist through that six-story railing. I'm going to have to escape those handcuffs using picks, which are on my body right here, get through four sets of doors, five padlocks, of which he supplied as well, make it to the roof to a helicopter that will be hovering 30 feet above with a ladder that they'll drop. I'll have to let that ladder touch the ground out, grab that ladder, fly to 1,000 feet while the building implodes. Right there, man.
You mentioned Cirque du Soleil. You've got your own show opening on October the 10th, I think, in Vegas at the Luxor. They must have had some reservations about you attempting something so dangerous.
Like I said, the owner, who's a dear friend of mine, just called me like 3 days ago, along with everybody else, Serge Dettencourt and the wonderful team. They're all dear friends. The show is going amazing, but they're like, you get killed, you twist your ankle. You know, we spent millions and millions of dollars. Felix Rappaport, same thing, but I have to do this. This is my last big demonstration, the biggest, the baddest, the most insane, and I promised my mother right there that I would not do another one, and I will not do another one after this one.
What is your oath? Well, let's take a look at what they had to say at the Luxor and Cirque du Soleil.
The message of the show is believe. Believe in yourself, believe in life.
I like to describe the show as Chris in Wonderland. So it's a journey, a lot of emotion.
There's never been an illusionist like Chris Angel.
He's an artist. He's somebody who's risky, he's edgy. It's the most complicated thing I've ever done in my life.
Well, the reality is when I hear the word implosion, that to me means danger and risk. We've got $100 million invested, and we really don't want anything to happen to our star.
I don't want to talk about the implosion. Chris knows exactly what I think about it.
But I'm pretty nervous about the whole implosion. The reality is I want him to come out of that in one piece. There's clearly a lot of concern about Chris's safety, but what exactly happens when a building is imploded? Here's an explanation.
I am here right now with a gentleman who's responsible to really lead the orchestration in the demolition of this 9-story building. Eric Kelly, nice to see you, from AED. Now, tell me the particulars for the people at home about this implosion.
Chris, we'll be utilizing about 450 sticks of dynamite, which is about 220 pounds of explosives.
Wow. And when that thing goes, what do we see?
We try to utilize the mechanisms within the detonators to incline the building a certain way. So what you'll probably hear is an initial 14 different individual blasts. Right. And then you'll hear secondary 14 blasts within the same time sequence. And then you'll see the building move in a specific direction in accordance with each of those detonations.
How long does that process take?
20 seconds from the initial pop till when the last brick falls.
When this building basically implodes upon itself and it comes barreling to the earth, what type of perimeter will that debris be in?
We'll keep it within its own footprint, which is about 20 feet.
20 feet. What would prevent this from taking place from your perspective?
If we get into a lightning situation.
And lightning, obviously, because it would potentially detonate the dynamite. It would give it the charge.
That would be a bad thing.
And how do you handle dynamite?
Carefully.
That's my line. This 450 sticks of dynamite that will implode this building in 20 seconds. This 4,500 tons of concrete that will come barreling to the earth. My hope is that I'm not in its path.
Dynamite is real, the danger is extreme. When we come back, Chris performs an amazing illusion, and stay tuned for the live event as Chris is handcuffed to a building about to implode. Stunning Clearwater Beach, Florida, where Chris Angel is preparing for his most spectacular and dangerous event ever. A daring escape from that 6-story balcony before a massive implode pulverizes the building. What makes Chris's demonstration so special is that he performs his illusions up close, in your face, often right on the street. Take a look at one he recently performed at his home in Las Vegas.
What are you doing?
I'll tell you.
looking for my tequila. We just came back from Mexico looking for my tequila.
Yeah, tequila is not in my bag. Joaquin, seriously, it's not in my bag.
Yeah, you put my tequila in your bag, so.
No, I put your tequila's over here. Come, John, you're my witness, John. Look. Look. He's a little loco. Here's your tequila, okay? You got it? Stop looking at me! Stop!
Watch this!
Stop! It's my girlfriend stuff! Stop it! Stop it!
Hey, you stole the sheets from the hotel!
I did not steal from the hotel.
No. I say shit, okay. In Spanish, it's sábanas.
Dude.
Te robaste las sábanas del hotel.
Listen, this is from my girlfriend, okay?
From your girlfriend?
No, this is from my girlfriend.
From your girlfriend?
Yes, from Mexico,
girlfriend.
Yes.
Your girlfriend from Mexico?
Yes.
You don't have any girlfriends in Mexico?
I do so.
Who?
Guadalupe.
Lupita.
No, Guadalupe.
Guadalupe?
Yes. Do you guys want to meet Guadalupe, my girl? I want to point out that there's people all around. As a matter of fact, we have a camera over here, we have John over here, and you guys are my witnesses, all 360 degrees around, right? All right, so listen. Listen to me. Over here, come and help me. Just put it over, just like this, all right? That's good, like this, good. Good, okay, that's good. Pick up the back for me. Pick it up for me. I want you to see something. Watch. Open up the back, and I want to show everybody that there's nothing underneath. Come on. Okay. Get a shot of this, Sean. Really, check this out. Is that fair, folks?
Yeah!
Fair, right? Okay. Now watch. Let it go. Let the back go. I'm gonna say now! Bah!
The most amazing thing ever.
She wasn't in there. He put the sheet over, and I can't even believe it. I'm all flustered.
I'm still trying to figure out how this girl came out from nowhere. Chris was awesome.
With me is Clearwater Fire Chief Jamie Greer, who is responsible for the safety of the event today. Chief, what precautions have you taken?
Tim, we're deploying an engine company, a truck company, two paramedic companies. We, along with the Clearwater Police Department, will do a final sweep of the building before giving the okay to proceed.
The okay. Well, we certainly appreciate all of your department's assistance. Chris is planning on getting out, we know that. So let's take a look at his escape plan.
I'm on the sixth floor of the Spyglass Hotel, where I'll begin my escape. I'll be manacled through this railing with handcuffs, and I'll begin picking my way out of them.
These are police regulation, top-of-the-line handcuffs.
I'll make my way to the first of four doors. Each will have a lock. I will pick my way through that lock, make my way into the room. Once I pick my way through this lock, I'll make my way, and I'll make a left turn. I'll run down this hall as fast as I possibly can. I'll have to pick this lock. All of the stairs below the sixth floor have been completely removed. This is to ensure that the building will implode completely. The only way out of here is up to the roof. I'll then have to make my way up very quickly, a three stories of stairs to get to the ninth floor to meet the final door, which is a roof hatch. I'll pick this, open it up, go to the top of the roof where the helicopter will drop a ladder. I will climb that ladder and we will ascend up to 1,000 feet to be in a safe zone. It's imperative that I'm on this roof on time. I am literally 1 second late. That helicopter will have to leave without me.
We keep emphasizing the danger of this escape, so we thought we'd give you a look at what makes this demonstration so dangerous and death-defying.
I really don't know why Christopher is doing all these dangerous things.
Anything could go wrong on this.
If, God forbid, the implosion malfunctions, Chris will die.
It's all about that timing.
So that he doesn't get injured or killed.
Chris may not get out of the shackles in time. He's got to get through the door that's locked to the stairwell. He's got to get through the door that's locked to get to the roof. There's no room for error.
And even if he escapes and makes it to the roof, will he do it in time? There's no guarantees.
He misses any one of those potential escapes.
I hate to even think what the repercussions are. Chris is going to be there right in the center of it all.
The pressure on Chris to pick the locks, escape from the building, I just don't see how he's going to do it.
The noise, the thunderous sounds falling to the ground and dust and debris and just things flying all over the place. It's going to be like 10 train cars smashing into each other. And the vibration that'll be felt along the ground will be like a massive earthquake.
We want Clearwater to be known as a destination place for a fun time, not to be well known for Chris Angel's last stunt.
If Chris is inside the building when this implosion happens, 4,500 tons of concrete will fall on him. He will die.
450 sticks of dynamite, 4,500 tons of concrete and steel. Nothing can survive that. But when we return, Chris Angel is going to try. And while he prepares, we're going to show you another incredible illusion. So, stay tuned. Humid Clearwater Beach, Florida, for this truly amazing feat of daring that Chris Angel is preparing to attempt. This is the ultimate test of physical strength, mental toughness, and Chris's skills in the art of escape. In a minute, we'll talk to Chris to see how he's handling the pressure of a demonstration that could prove to be his last. In the meantime, here's another of Chris's unbelievable illusions.
Luxor, the parking lot, with all of these folks right here. How we doing? All right. As a matter of fact, I see a bunch of my cars in a circle here, and a bunch of people kind of making a human car chain in a horseshoe right over here, and then you're all the eyes and witnesses in front of that horseshoe. You know how to work a cameraman?
Yeah.
All right. What's your name?
John.
All right, John, you are going to operate the spectator's point of view camera. You can shoot anywhere you want. You have an all-access pass. I want you to be the eyes and the witness for all those folks at home watching this right now. Go anywhere you want. This is what I've been called out here by this man, Count, from Count's Customs.
What's up?
Good friend of mine. A little crazy, but a good friend. I also have the amazing Jonathan.
And Cole, homie.
And he loves cars, so he wanted to come see some of my cars. And then Joey from Findlay, who does a lot of my car work, the Hummer, the Escalade, the Lambo, Viper, everything. And
the 69 Camaro.
Well, yeah, he's working on it with you, right?
Well, he's done.
All right, well, is that why we're here? Gonna see the 69? Yeah! We're gonna see the 69 Z28.
That's right.
All right, where's George? Is he gonna drive it up?
It's right here, your 69 Z28 Camaro. We've been working on for months, right here. She's right here. Come here.
I see a car cover.
Come on, crack through.
No, you know what's funny? Is that he's gonna be like, do magic. He's gonna make it appear.
Oh, no, yeah. I leave the magic up to you, but nice segue here. There has been a lot of magic created at my shop in building the 69 Camaro Z28.
You do insane work.
Yeah,
and man. You were supposed to get like other people to do the front end of the car.
Yeah, total cost involved, right. Man. They gave me the front end to do the whole tubular front end. It's phenomenal.
They're the best. This is the problem.
Yeah.
Bring the car. Let's
She's
check
right
it out.
Here.
You
want to
see it?
She's right here. She's
do you guys
beautiful.
See a car? Is he nuts? Do you see it? Check it out. You know what?
Yeah.
Go over there by the Piper. Go over there.
Now?
Keep an eye on him. All right? And where's the spectators cam? Come over here, brother. What's your first name again?
John.
I see John, and for the folks at home, I see my Viper right here. I see.
So for this demonstration, I created a human barrier around my cars, making it completely impossible for anything to come in or out.
All right, good. Now, all right, you see nothing here. I see nothing here. They say it's a car here. You say it's a car here, right?
Yeah!
All right, you know what? Can you do me a favor? Raise the car cover up. Raise it up. And I want you to cover the apparent invisible Z28 Camaro. Cover it up for me. Good. Cover it
it's
up.
It's right there, man.
Go ahead.
It is right
Give
there.
That a cover. Good. That's perfect. Good. Now, huh. I see what, Count?
The 69Z. She's right here. 69Z28. She's right here. There's the
All right, let me just humor you. Spectators cam. Take a look. Take a look. Trevor, take a look back here. All right, get a good shot of this.
No doubt.
Because if it's not here, Count.
Yeah.
I don't have to pay for Check this out. Are you ready?
Yeah!
No! I see six fantasy girls. Six fantasy girls right here. Come on, ladies. Come here. Beautiful fantasy. Six reasons why. I'll see you later. You know what I mean? I'm busy. John, get a shot everywhere because I'm going to be a little tied up, as they say.
Hey, Chris, what year was that car?
The 69.
69, good number.
I saw the car there. I saw all the cars wrapped around. None of the cars moved. And the next thing I knew, the car was gone.
We were standing right here the whole time. We were standing between these two cars the whole time.
The car was right there. Yeah, it was right there, and it just disappeared.
What happened to the car? Where did it go?
Chris, we just thought you were having a little bit of fun there. This is a very different animal tonight. It's a live show. How are you feeling?
Well, I've done everything I possibly could do in my training, you know, physically, mentally, and even spiritually. But at the end of the day, Tim, you never know what can happen. I mean, and the stress level and the pressure, and if my heart increases to the point where it sacrifices my performance, I could be very much in the same situation as a police officer who's a great marksman, but when they're in a live combat situation, their performance suffers.
So there are nerves?
Of course.
Well, I'm sure a live audience and everyone at home, and especially those at the Luxor, will be feeling those nerves tonight. When we come back, Chris is going to need some help from someone in our audience, so stay tuned. Edition of Chris Angel Mind Freak. Just minutes from now, Chris Angel will be handcuffed to the sixth floor balcony of the hotel behind me. He will have to pick his way out of the handcuffs, make his way through three locked doors, up three flights of stairs, scale a ladder and through a double locked hatch in time to catch a ladder dangling from a helicopter that will hopefully whisk him to safety. All before a timer detonates 450 sticks of dynamite, bringing the building crashing to the earth. So, who's ready to blow up a building?
Yeah!
Chris, I was with you earlier today when you randomly selected somebody from the audience. How did you do that, and why did you do that?
I basically just took my wristband off, threw it into the crowd of loyals. Somebody selected it, and I did it because I wanted somebody to be the eyes and the ears for the people at home, because I always say what you see is what you get, and it's no BS.
Well, this is the witness here, and that is the actual wristband.
This is the actual wristband.
And you're not nervous of heights?
We'll find out.
Well, hopefully you'll be okay. Also with us is Officer Dave Hardman, a retired lieutenant who served for 26 years on the Clearwater Police Force. It was very important that he came today because of what?
Well, he's supplying the 5 padlocks and the handcuffs, which I still have not seen. He's an integral part of making this completely legitimate.
And completely unattached to the show in all ways.
That's correct.
Do you have your handcuffs with you?
I do.
Well, is everybody too ready to head up? We'll see you later on, Chris. Okay. Good luck. We'll see you guys later. While Chris and the witnesses make their way to the truck, let's take a look at how Chris has trained for this very difficult escape.
I had to get in the best shape of my life. I have the most challenging escape of my career. This is the riskiest thing I've ever done in my life. And I've already sworn to my mom. After this one, I'm done. I'm here at the airport in Clearwater, Florida, training with none other than these two gentlemen. We got Paul over here.
How you doing, Chris?
You're the pilot.
Yes, sir.
And John, who's coordinating the final outcome, we hope. Me getting to that ladder, ascending 1,000 feet before the building implodes.
It's gonna be an e-ticket ride.
I'm gonna teach you how to safely get on this ladder. Learn how to step on correctly, hang on correctly, because then Paul, of course, is gonna whisk you away to safety.
For the folks at home that are watching this, you have to understand, even though the entire running time of this escape is 4 minutes, the helicopter has to leave at 3 minutes and 30 seconds to give it 30 seconds to climb to a safe zone where the building can implode and not pull the helicopter down. So if I'm there at 3:31?
At 3:30, we gotta go.
Hope I'm not waving to you.
What Chris needs to do to safely get on this ladder, he needs to wait until the helicopter ladder is even with his feet. There's a foot in front and a foot in back. That way, when he's hanging on, he's not kicking the ladder way out to the side here, which is harder to hang on. So that'll keep the ladder straight up and down.
He wants to do the big thing. I think he's ready. It's no problem for him. He doesn't want a safety belt on. I think if he just goes straight up and down, he'll be fine.
Chris will not have any kind of a safety. He's holding on through his own physical strength. It would take too much dangerous time for him to try to hook himself in and then get on the ladder. This is something that's got to happen in a matter of a couple of seconds.
Good, I feel confident. We spent an hour doing this. No problem. I'll have another rehearsal next week when I come back to Clearwater. Make sure I'm all full, but I feel great.
As you can see, Chris and the witness are now on there. They're on the 6th floor of that balcony of the Spyglass Hotel.
I can hear him.
Chris, can you hear me?
You're breaking up on me, but I can hear you barely.
Safety is of the essence here. I want you to hear me. So what happens next, Chris?
Good. Are you hearing?
I can hear you. What happens next, Chris?
Okay, you ready me to take everybody through what's going to happen in a room?
We are. We'd like to see what you're going to do.
Ready? Yes, yes, yes. Okay, here we go. I'm going to ask the lieutenant and Ashley, correct? Ashley, come on in the room. I want you to see that we have cameras placed strategically throughout my path to the roof. And you see the cameras that are placed on a wall and throughout this room and throughout the entire path, the staircase, and the roof. This is 2 doors of 4 that will now be locked to join the other two. I'm going to ask you both to come over here. I should show you really quickly. Come here. I want you to see I'm going to run down this hall to door number 3, which is locked. Okay? And now we're going to lock door number 2. Here we go. And I'm going to ask you to have the honors, Ashley.
Okay.
Lock that and check the lock. You happy? Lieutenant, I want you to verify, is this the same lock
yes.
that you gave me
it is.
To utilize? Okay, fair enough?
Fair enough.
We'll go out, we'll make our way to the balcony. We're going to lock the entry point into this room. The other, only other way out of this room is that door that we just locked. Here's door number one. Come on, folks. We're going to lock this right now. Lieutenant, please lock that. Check it. Fair enough?
Fair enough.
Okay. The only unfinished business, Tim, is handcuffing me to this railing on the sixth-story balcony.
Chris, it looks like they've made your escape a bit more difficult. When we return, our witness and police officer will handcuff Chris.
They absolutely did. I'm having a rough time hearing you, Tim, but they did.
Well, it's a live show. That's what we should expect. They're going to handcuff Chris to the balcony rail. And then it's finally implosion time. So don't go anywhere. Clearwater Beach, Florida, where Chris Angel is ready to be chained onto the sixth-floor balcony of the Spyglass Hotel right behind me. In just a few moments, that hotel will be reduced to a pile of rubble, and you're going to witness it live. No more breaks, no more commercials. It's going to happen now. So, let's go up to Chris, Ashley, and Chief Hardman.
Chris? Tim, I'm having a bit of a problem hearing you, but right now I'm going to ask the lieutenant to reveal to me for the first time what brand of handcuffs will you be using?
Smith & Wesson.
Can I see them? Okay, I'm going to ask you to place my left wrist in the handcuff. Okay. Now we're going to take my hand, put it through the railing. I want to just prep myself with my picks right here. These are my picks right over here. And my little timer right there, because I have to have a stopwatch so I know where I am at what point. Are you satisfied?
Satisfied.
These are your handcuffs.
They are.
You put this on many of criminals?
One or two.
Thank you very much. I'm going to ask you all to go to a safe zone, including the cameraman. I need you to give me a cue because I can't hear anything.
Well, Chief Hardman and Ashley are lowered to the ground. We can see that now. They will be moved to a safe distance from the building. Let me just recap exactly what is going to happen and the timing of that implosion. Chris is now completely alone in the building. When Chris is ready, he will give the signal and the automatic detonator sequence will begin. Once it starts, Chris will have just 3.5 minutes to get to the roof and the rescue helicopter. 30 seconds later, the building will implode. We will be able to follow Chris's progress inside the building through a series of live, unmanned, continuous cameras. Now, ladies and gentlemen, as a safety precaution, we encourage you now to put on your masks,
and your earplugs. Part of the process of imploding the building is the final area sweep and safety check, which is being handled by the Clearwater Police Department. Now, the final implosion countdown cannot begin until the police have given the OK. Our demolition team from Advanced Explosives Demolition is standing by for that clearance. There are 48 people involved with the check, and every one of them must individually signal all clear before the implosion can proceed. Now, that final check and sweep of the area is taking place right now as I'm speaking. All I can think about is that it must be incredibly stressful for Chris, who is waiting on the balcony. We're also having sound problems, so he's up there on his own. He can hear me occasionally. There's nobody here more concerned for Chris's safety than his family. His mother, Dimitra, brothers JD and Costa, are quietly, very quietly, watching from the audience area just behind the camera. Now, Chris has promised his mother that this will be his final dangerous escape. I'm not sure if we should chat to the family at the moment, but we're ready for Chris.
The rain,
JD,
it started to rain here.
JD, come over here.
Starting
we just
to
need
rain.
The microphone. If you can stand over here. JD, Costa, you can speak over to me at the moment, but what is going through his mind at the moment? You've been here before.
Yes, he's got to stay focused. He's got to remember exactly every little detail he's got to do.
He's very methodical. I think he's just running through in his mind what he has to do. He's been practicing. Obviously, handcuffs he's been doing since a kid. But I just think he's going through every step in his mind that he has to do between all the picking up the handcuffs, the locks, the doors, running through the hallway, going up three flights of steps, onto the roof, onto the ladder of the helicopter.
He's a cool customer. I think we're more nervous than him.
I'm pacing, and he was just hanging out.
I think my heart is going faster than his.
One thing that he did make very clear that he's promised this will be his last dangerous live event.
He did promise the family that this here will be the last life-threatening demonstration that he will do.
One thing that I was particularly concerned about is that it's been raining heavily all day.
Yeah.
But there's also, it's dried up, but there's a lot of humidity. Everybody's sweating. Will that affect him?
I think that he's a very focused man. I think that if he stays with that and concentrates on what he's got to do, I pray that he'll get
it.
Yeah, that's true. The moisture in his hands and his perspiration. Yeah, it's a factor. It's very thick here. We had a lot of rain today, so it might be a factor. I hope to God it's not, but it may.
Thank you very much, Costa. Right. JD, we'll see you later.
All right, thank you.
Now, this does create more of a problem for his escape. We've just spoken about the humidity. Chris, can you hear me now?
I can, and I can tell you that it's not necessarily just humidity. It's actually raining. It's on my hands, if you look, which makes for a slippery floor and makes for slippery picks.
Chris, I don't even know what to say to that, but have you got any final words?
I just want to say from my heart, thank you to Clearwater Beach. All of you have been just an amazing, wonderful group of people. I love you all. And to my family, mom, and my brothers, Cupcake, everybody, thank you so much. I sincerely love you and believe.
Now, I just want to confirm that we are safe to continue.
Okay.
Okay, Chris.
Are you ready? Yeah.
Chris has one handcuff off so far. He's already mentioned the humidity and the rain. The other big issue will be the handcuffs and the first lock on the first door, because that's been exposed to the elements. I've just heard that the helicopter is now coming into a safe position, so it's hovering over that building. That's 40 seconds gone already, Chris. Nearly a minute gone. He seems to be having a problem with the door on the balcony. He's trying to... I can honestly say this has not happened. He's kicking in one of the glasses, as you can speak. There must have been some problem with the door. 2 minutes, 50 seconds. Chris hoped to be on the roof within 2.5 minutes. So he's way behind. Come on, Chris! 2 minutes, 30 seconds gone, Chris. Remember, he has to have 30 seconds on top of that roof and be away before the helicopter will leave. We now see the multi-screen. At no point is there an uninterrupted view of Chris. Chris is the only person left in that building. All these cameras are unmanned. You can see in the center of your screen the helicopter. That's his mother, Demetra. Now, Chris wanted to be on the roof with plenty of time to spare. The final door has two locks on it, the latch to the ceiling. He's running up that final set of stairs. OK, he's at the final latch, but this one has two locks on it. One minute 30, Chris. The helicopter must take off with 30 seconds left, whatever happens. This is to ensure that the helicopter is a safe distance away from the implosion. And I have to say that Chris was hoping to be on top of that roof 20, 30 seconds ago. There seems to be some kind of problem with the lock. I know this is television, but this is a live event. I am actually... This is very frightening now. 40 seconds left, Chris. 40 seconds. There seems to be a problem with the second lock. Okay, he should already be... Okay, 30 seconds. The helicopter should now... 24 seconds. Chris! Chris should have already been leaving the building at 30 seconds. 15 seconds. There seems to be a huge problem now. 8 seconds, Chris. The helicopter's had to leave. It was not rehearsed. What's happened? Is Chris... Okay, I'm being told in my ear that they're looking for Chris. Obviously, on our cameras, he was still stuck inside. He had a problem with the first and final door. The helicopter had to leave. It needed 30 seconds to get away from the implosion. I've never heard 15,000 people being so quiet. In rehearsals, he very safely made it to the helicopter, but... Okay. Chris's family are now running over. I don't know quite where they're running to. But there's obviously... The dust is starting to settle now. Nothing could have got out of there safely. Nothing. The helicopter that you can hear is the rescue helicopter that couldn't do anything for Chris and had to leave within the 30-second time limit. The family are just standing there looking for... I'm not sure what they're looking for. We have a camera crew that's running at the far end of the building. We're told it's safe to go somewhere closer. Chris Angel is out and alive! Ladies and gentlemen, unbelievable.
I don't think I've ever seen a family more relieved to see Chris. He looks quite shaken and covered in 4,500 tons of dust, but he is alive.
You right?
He's having a hug from Pastor JD's brother and his mother, Dimitra. It's obviously in slight shock. It's probably the understatement of the evening. We're not sure if we're going to get a chance to speak to Chris because obviously it hasn't gone as planned. Well, that's it from this special live edition of Chris Angel. With a special thanks to the thousands of fans, 15,000 of them, coming out here to watch this amazing performance. For continuing live coverage tonight's event, go to aetv.com and chrisangel.com. And before we say goodnight, I think the audience here in our main set area has something to say. Ready? One, two, three, Mike!